goodness. A lot of people here. Good evening, everyone. No, let me try that again. Good evening, everyone. That's much better. We're a communication school, and we like to hear that enthusiasm. I'm delighted to see so many of you here this evening. This is a really important discussion. It's an important discussion for the United States of America, and it's certainly an important discussion for those of you, young people, millennials, and others who are working in the industry. And it's also important for the Annenberg School for Communication and Journalism, where we take these things very, very seriously. We're going to talk about the diversity report card. I understand that there have been 9 billion hits or something like that already. Stacy has done a tremendous job in getting the word out around these important issues, but I'm going to let her describe the details. What I would like to do is say a little bit about the Annenberg School for Communication and Journalism. My name is Ernest Wilson. I'm the Dean of the Annenberg School for Communication and Journalism. The first thing I need to do is give a shout out to Frank Cruz, who's sitting right here in the front, who is a member of the Board of Trustees. Frank? Frank was chairman of the board of the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and was one of the founders of Telemundo and has just had a very distinguished career, and I'm proud to say is also a member of the Board of Counselors for the Annenberg School. I also want to take this opportunity to say, give a shout out to Mr. Cisneros, Gil, who is here. If you would take a bow, Gil, who is a real friend of the school. His wife, Jackie, has achieved the highest standing ever. She's a graduate of the Annenberg School. And Gil and Jackie have been very supportive of our media center here. So I want to welcome him as well. Thanks, Gil. So let me say a few words about the Annenberg School for Communication and Journalism. And I just want to say that the kind of analysis and engagement that we are presenting today grows from our USC Annenberg culture of deep analysis on the one hand, combined with equally deep and passionate and widespread engagement with society. So it's not just an academic piece of work, it's also an engaged, practical piece of work. Our prize-winning faculty, that we do research and produce scholarship on diversity and inclusion, and they spend lots of time working in practical ways with our professional colleagues in the world of journalism and communication and public relations and entertainment. From the work that we do with local high schools here in this neighborhood, all the way to Warner Brothers, Disney, France Telecom, Epics, the World Bank, and Shanghai Media Group. So we're engaged with the world as well as doing what we hope is critical analysis. The Annenberg team was selected by the Federal Communications Commission several years ago to do research that looked at the way the changing technology and the changing demographics fit together. And we think that is important work that we're going to continue. But let me just say a word about what we have found to be really important. Diversity is a nice thing, okay? Yes, it's nice. Inclusion is important, okay? Inclusion is important. But frankly, it ain't enough. Inclusion and diversity simply means you are invited to come into the room, and too often it means sit down and shut up and don't say anything that's disruptive. We've created something called the Institute for Diversity and Empowerment at Annenberg. And the operative word here is empowerment. Empowerment and empowerment. It's not enough for women to be invited into the room and be expected to present the same kind of views as men in order to proceed, or Latinos, or African Americans. Not all the times, but sometimes they have different perspectives. And those different perspectives are important for the survival of the United States of America in order to move into a diverse, multicultural world. So what we try to emphasize here at the Annenberg School is not just inclusion. That is just the beginning the starting point. The important point is, are women's voices allowed to be heard to present their unique perspective? The same thing with Asian Americans, or African Americans, or Latinos. And so as we move forward in the work that we're doing at the Annenberg School, which we've been doing for 20 years, providing an environment where these kinds of opportunities can move forward. But of course, the idea of change and power has to begin with knowledge. And with that, I want to introduce the person who has probably produced as much knowledge about diversity and inclusion and empowerment as anybody else in the United States of America. In fact, when LA Weekly said, who are the 10 most important people, influential people in Los Angeles? Eli Broad was number 10. Some of you will know who he is. He's just a billionaire. A friend, I should say. He's a wonderful billionaire. But so 10, 9, 8, 7, 6. When they got to number one, Professor Stacy Smith was selected to be the most influential person in Los Angeles. And she was selected because she represents the future. She is the future. She's already in the future, looking back to help the rest of us who aren't quite there yet to get to the future. She is the founder and director of the Media Diversity and Social Change Initiative here at USC. And without further ado, let me turn over the floor to one of our most distinguished professors, who's also deeply engaged in the real world, my heroine, Stacy Smith.
Well, that was an amazing introduction. I can't wait to hear what I'm going to say. Thank you, Ernie. That was very gracious. We've been working on this report since April. And as I have been telling everyone for weeks, as I've been getting calls and inquiries about when is this going to be finished, I said it's going to be one word, a photo finish, to cross the line before the Oscars. But I'm here today to say we actually made it. And there's a few people that made this progress and this journey with this report in particular just extraordinary, and I need to point them out. They're all in the room. First, I need to extend a heartfelt thanks to the director of the Institute for Diversity and Empowerment at Annenberg and the director of the Annenberg School for Communication. This individual greenlit this project at the price point we actually needed to do it, which is a novelty in the academy. She's an amazing colleague and friend, and that's Dr. Sarah Benet Weiser. Couldn't do it without you. There's also so many amazing people that pulled off this event tonight. There are too many to count all of their names, so I apologize in advance if I miss someone. But Gretchen, you have been extraordinary in planning the entire press release and working tirelessly up till today. 950 plus articles on this study today. So thank you, Gretchen. All of the graphics that you'll see tonight have been done by Patricia Lapadula. I don't know where she is, but she's an amazing graphic artist that does all of our work, worked all throughout the weekend. Of course, Helen Harbor and Kylie Mace planned this event, which is absolutely extraordinary. And then our development team, Diana O'Leary and Tracy Mendoza. Heartfelt thanks. I'm halfway through with my introductions and thank you, so bear with me. There are two people that for the last 10 years have stood by my side through study after study after study. We've been working on this, and they are my eyes, they are my ears. They provide the tactile experiences that I need with data, and those are my amazing co-authors, Dr. Catherine Pieper and Mark Schwede. So thank you. It is because of their intelligence, their commitment, and their value to inclusion that our work is truly outstanding. We also had two other co-authors on the project who I'd like to acknowledge, Ariana Case and Artur Tofan. Where are you? There they are. And then the heart and soul of everything that we do is our undergraduates. We work with over a team of 100 students in our lab to work on this report, to finish it. They gave their nights, they gave their weekends, they gave their winter break to help us cross the finish line. We're all incredibly grateful for your tenacity, your attention to detail, and your commitment to this team. If you are an MDSC research assistant on this project, please stand and let your voices be heard. They are the true stars tonight. I only have a few minutes because I want to get to the guests. They're amazing luminaries that came in to talk about this particular issue. So I'm just going to spend a few moments and tell you about what we did and what we found that has been making headlines across so many media outlets today. The purpose of the card investigation, it's bright because something is glowing behind my head. The purpose of this investigation was to answer a few central questions. In particular, we were interested in how inclusive is Hollywood when it comes to on-screen portrayals of gender, race, ethnicity, and the LGBT community. How inclusive is Hollywood in hiring practices behind the camera? And how inclusive is Hollywood in its executive ranks from the C-suite to SVPs? To this end, to answer each of these questions, what we did is we did three large-scale investigations, essentially. First, we looked at on-screen. We were curious as to who was appearing on-screen in popular media content. We looked at 109 motion pictures, the entire slate across multiple media companies of the content that they distribute of their major studio brand as well as their art house or niche divisions. We also looked at 305 fictional primetime shows and digital series. And what we evaluated was every speaking character. Every speaking character that spoke one word on screen or more was included in our sample. That's a very low bar. We also turned to behind the camera. We looked at directors and writers across every episode of every series evaluated. This actually clocks to 10,705 content creators. We also looked at showrunners. We were also interested for the first time at the Media Diversity and Social Change Initiative at individuals working in the executive ranks. So we looked at gender from CEOs all the way down to senior vice presidents. This allowed us to look at inclusion across the ranks, or as we're saying, from CEO to every speaking character on screen. So what did we find? Well, in the interest of time, I'm only going to highlight a few major results. They will not be a surprise to many in the room. First, let me tell you about the companies we evaluated. We looked at 10 major media companies. That's what's unique in this report. We focused on the companies rather than focusing on programs or specific movies. Every media holding across these companies, film, television, digital, provided that they ranked in a certain score on popularity, were included in the investigation. 414 stories total. So now, what did we find? First off, females are underrepresented on screen across the ecosystem of entertainment. Across 11,306 speaking characters, only a third were girls and women. This calculates into a gender ratio of 2 males to every 1 female. No surprise, film is the worst offender. Streaming content, digital series, do the best. 38% of all characters were girls and women. However, only 18% of all shows featured girls and women in roughly half of all the roles. Only 18% of the stories evaluated had a gender-balanced cast. This is surprising given that females represent 50% of the population and go to the box office often. They also watch a lot of television. So they're being erased, if you think about it, on screen. They're also missing behind the camera, particularly in film. Across 4,284 directors, 414 films, TV shows, and digital offerings, 85% of all directors were male. only 15% are female. The norm at the DGA is 23%, so it's even below the DGA norm, and it calculates into a gender ratio of 5.6 to 1. Film, again, no surprise, is the worst offender, but broadcast is the best. 17% of all directors are women. Now, if we look to the executive suite, we find some interesting patterns. We've looked at 1,558 executives, roughly 20% of the C-suite, CEO, COO, CFOs, board of directors, and executive management teams were women. Turning to media platform, however, gender was related to position. Less than a quarter of all top executives were women. Just under a third, or over a third, of EVPs were female, and nearly half of SVPs were female. This overall pattern tells a very familiar story in our research. As power increases, female participation decreases, which once again be surprising to a room filled with females. There was one notable deviation that's going to become important in just a few minutes that I want to draw your attention to. The ranks of television are almost at parity at the senior vice president and the executive vice president level, right in the middle. This will help explain some findings in just a few minutes. Now, there are still specific groups that face invisibility or erasure in the media. Across 414 stories, the infographic is going to show you a picture as these are broken down by the media platform, but listen to my words to hear what I'm going to say about different groups in the media. We looked at 414 stories. 21% of those stories featured not one Black or African American speaking character. Not one. Over 50% of all the stories we evaluated did not feature one Asian or one Asian American speaking character on screen. Not one. Turning to the LGBT community, it's also problematic. Out of 11,194 speaking or name characters that could be evaluated on this measure, only 229 were coded as LGBT. Most were white, most were male, and most were not depicted as parents, which is problematic for a variety of reasons. Summing up across gender, race, and ethnicity and the LGBT community findings, I've been saying all day, we don't have a diversity problem. We have an inclusion crisis. However, up until this point in time in the research, and in most of the research we do, we look at each of these factors individually or in isolation, rather than in terms of intersectionality. And we started to wonder on our team, what would happen if we started looking across these factors, across groups on screen, and across behind-the-scenes hiring practices? And what would happen if we actually did what we're the best at as academics? Evaluation. What would happen if we graded media companies on inclusion across multiple measures? And so for the first time, we presented information in this report in the form of report cards, one for film and one for television and digital series. And we grade the industry on that oh-so-familiar scale of 0 to 100% on inclusion. You know the scale, where 90% is an A, or what we call fully inclusive. If there's 50% in the population are girls and women, guess what number should probably be in television, digital offerings, and film? 50%. And if 37% of the population is from underrepresented racial and ethnic groups, what might we suspect to find in film and television? Perhaps 37%. So we graded the industry 90, 80, 70, 60, below 60% is failing, just like many of you in the room are familiar with at midterms, which is right now, or finals. So what did we find with this inclusion score? And I'm gonna cut to the chase really quick because this doesn't require a lot of explanation. I want you to look on this film report card to your complete right. If 100% is perfect and 50% is failing, film has failed at inclusion. Whether it's
the U.S. norm for gender representation on screen and lead characters, underrepresented characters that are leads, or all speaking characters, or the LGBT community, and when we turn to behind the camera, it's far worse. Most companies are not hiring female directors, and very few are putting female writers behind the camera. In television, in comparison, television and digital did much better. Four companies were actually top performers, and I want to single out here two, and then talk about two more. On the first report card for television, I want you to look at the last line, the last row. Disney actually was a top performer across the Disney Channel, Disney Junior, Freeform, and ABC. And when I asked Pete to come tonight, he didn't know that his company was actually going to be a top performer. On average, no one knew until last night, I think, at 6 o'clock, or if there was going to be any top performers. I guess that was the bigger surprise. 47% of all characters and leads, inclusive, if 50% is the norm. Largely inclusive, 30% out of 37%. Largely inclusive of female creators, largely inclusive of female writers. The CW is also performing well across these platforms or across these indicators. If we just look to the next slide, I want to highlight two other companies that are doing well, Hulu and Amazon. And I want to point out one cell in particular. If you look across to Amazon, all the way down to female directors, there were only 3.4% of all directors in film last year were women. But in Amazon, across all of their offerings, 28% of all the directors were girls and women. These data show that companies can do it when they set their minds to do it. And if Disney can do it in television, that means Disney can also do it in film. And to this end, we map out several strategies for change in the report. So in conclusion, what we found is that some groups are still facing erasure on screen. Behind the camera, females face exclusionary hiring practices, and television and digital are far more inclusive than in film. Thank you very much. And at this point, I'd like to invite all the panelists up to have a discussion about how do we fix some of the problems we just saw. Thank you.
This is what you've all been waiting for, I can tell. Hi, I'm Dr. Catherine Pieper. I've worked with Stacy for longer than at least 10 years, quite a long time, and it's a thrill to be able to share with you the research that she just went over, and an even bigger thrill to be here with our panelists tonight. One of the themes that runs through the research we just released, and in fact all of our research, is the theme of opportunity. We're very interested in who's getting opportunities to be on screen and behind the camera in executive suites, and who isn't. And so tonight we're here to talk with how do we increase opportunity, how do we change the patterns that we're seeing. And so we have with us three individuals who really are opening up doors, creating opportunities, and are game changing in their approach to entertainment, though we'll see if they're humble enough to admit it or not. So Stacy, I'm going to throw it to you so you can introduce our guests.
So our three guests, I couldn't believe all of them said yes. And so I'm thrilled because, as Kate said, they are game changers. First is Stephanie Allain. You know all these people, whether you know them or not. She's produced multiple films that many of us adore, Beyond the Lights, Hustle and Flow, exec produced Dear White People. She also spent many years back in the day at Columbia. And what's interesting about Stephanie's career is that she spent a decade at the studio launching the careers of first-time filmmakers such as John Singleton, Robert Rodriguez, and Darnell Martin. Several of the films she supervised were El Mariachi and I Like It Like That, garnering awards at Cannes, Telluride, Sundance, etc. Currently, though, she blows everyone away as the director of the Los Angeles Film Festival. That's why I invited her here today. Arguably, it's one of the most inclusive film festivals in the country. Absolutely. You deserve a round of applause.
She has so many other accolades. Just real quick, a member of the Academy, a member of the Producers Guild, a member of Women in Film, board member at Phil Independent. She sits on the Spirit Awards nominating committee, or she's chaired it. Juried festivals, and she's even an adjunct professor right a few buildings down at this Peter Stark program. So thank you for being here.
Thank you.
Next, we have the creator, writer, and showrunner of the acclaimed How to Get Away with Murder, Pete Nowak. So Pete just inked an overall deal with ABC Studios. Congratulations. He's also about to receive the prestigious LGBTQ Community Award from the Point Foundation in New York. Congratulations. His show has broken records. Viola Davis won Lead Actress an Emmy for her role as Annalise Keating for the first African-American woman in a drama category. It's been the show decorated by the SAG Awards, GLAAD Awards, and before Murder, Pete was co-executive producer of that little show called Scandal, where he's written some of the most nail-biting episodes of primetime television. He's producer, writer, story editor on that other little show, Grey's Anatomy, in the past. He's co-authored a book called The Hollywood Assistant's Handbook, and he's a graduate of Brown University. Thanks for coming, Pete. And then we have Cathy Schulman, Academy Award winner for Crash and notable producer of a whole slate of other films. She's currently the head of production at STX Entertainment. Previously the president of Mandalay Pictures, president of Women in Film Los Angeles, that funds my research. She's a board member at Film Independent, a member of the Academy, a producing mentor at the USC Peter Stark program, teaches at the graduate level at UCLA, Chapman, and all over, but most importantly, a friend of Dr. Stacy Smith. Thanks for coming, Cathy. As Kate said, these are all game changers. They do things differently. And as they start to talk, you'll notice why their ecosystems within the industry look different than maybe some of the patterns we just saw on screen. Kate.
So I think to get started, we've just heard all these great findings. I mean, I think they're great, but I'm slightly biased. And we know as the public, as many of us from the public are here, what the conversation has been like about diversity, about inclusion in the last year, especially in the last several months. But we're hoping you can all lift the curtain a little bit, take the temperature of your own industry, and tell us what the internal conversations are like within the industry as they relate to inclusion. What's going on behind the doors that we can't access? Anybody? Free for all.
Okay. Well, the good news is it's changing. And I think it's changing for the first time. As a matter of fact, you know, having worked as a real sort of leader in this area for 10 years at least myself, around 3 years ago, I was into like super depression dip that we were never going to make any change. And it became terribly, terribly frustrating. It was just the rock that wouldn't go over the top of the hill. And I think based on some very, very concerted efforts of a number of groups, and I may say on behalf of Women in Film, led by Women in Film, we decided to get to the bottom of what was really happening here so that we could ultimately use that information to service change. And we are, at the moment, at a tipping point as it regards inclusion. You know, I've specifically been working on the gender issue, but timing-wise, it's intersecting, I think, well in terms of other areas. The amount of news and the proliferation of information went from, you know, papers like Variety and Hollywood Reporter all the way to the Wall Street Journal, New York Times, LA Times, and out, has been pushed through general media. And now there really is a demand to know what the heck is happening in this industry that should be so forward but is somehow so backwards. So I can at least say there's a bit demand to know and a nervousness about how this could still be happening. We're just at the beginning of putting some change plans in motion. And we're going to get into that, I'm sure, for the rest of this panel. But I can say it's a little better now because there's open arms. The danger, I guess, is that, you know, we've had a very calculated plan, particularly on the press side, to bring this issue to a tipping point. But it's very dangerous that we've made it hip and that it doesn't then get pushed right back under the rug because we can't deliver in terms of conversion. And that makes me not sleep at night, because can we move fast enough to keep this issue fevered enough that we actually make change? Because these movements have a funny way of being cool till the next movement happens and nothing changes. So that's kind of where I think our focus needs to be.
I can really just speak from my little TV bubble, which is kind of Shondaland in general, which is obviously I worked on all those shows, and I grew up in Shondaland University, as I like to say, which is a very progressive and forward-thinking environment. So I've been lucky to be in there. I will say, I don't even feel like it was till the past year or two that even within my writer's room and with my other writer colleagues that we would even talk about it. So I just want to, it's really due to your research and everything that's happening that we're even aware of it. I think, you know, as writers, you're just kind of like in your computer, you know, and you're not really thinking of it. And luckily, I've been, you know, raised and mentored by people who just made it a part of the subconscious of writing within Shondaland. And I think just types of shows that I've liked and the worlds I wanted to create to make them more inclusive. And because to me, all good story comes from, you know, conflict and like what's, it's not gonna be fun to have two Republicans talking to each other on your TV show. So I think what's interesting, like what Cathy was saying, is like we all now are very aware of the problem. It's all we're talking about. Like, for example, a place that I feel like my show has really failed is with hiring enough women directors. And even, it wasn't really on my mind so much when I was hiring people for the first season. You know, I do it with a lot of other people and there's a lot of checks and balances, but it's like, oh, we need directors tomorrow. And I think what's good right now is that there's no like, oh, just hire the first 10 people on the list and you'll be done and we can all relax. That's not acceptable anymore. But there's still a lot more work to be done, because from my point of view, the problem with hiring directors is the list is limited. And so it's like, how do I help expand the list? How do we all help expand the list and move forward from there? So I think really, just to answer your question, like it just feels like only now are we really aware of it and really talking about it in the way that feels productive. And I don't know where we go from here. Like I'm excited to be here because I want to take away some information and take it home.
I can give you information
steps
on your show if you're interested afterwards.
Good. That's actually, well, good point, because I was like, you need to get, like, you have all the study, because I was going to call my assistant and be like, do the analysis on our show.
No, we have it.
Great.
So we can talk.
You should give it to every showrunner. I think.
Actually, that's a great idea. So we'll start emailing tomorrow.
Yeah. Done. It's happening.
Everything. Because I'm sure there's real horrible things about her that I don't even know. Like you're saying all these great things about it. I'm like, I'm sure we've messed up in some way due to my implicit biases and all of that stuff. So please give me that.
I'll be sending. I don't want to cut Stephanie off because I'm sure you have a lot to say about this, but I think he points out a really good point that I just wanted to say right now, which is the power of numbers. When we got, and I want to talk about how we got into the research at the right time, but what I can say is that the specific decision made 3 years ago now today to figure out the best way to collect numbers for actual use and to understand the numbers beyond just counting them, you know, became so crucial. And you can see how directly, when people can see exactly what's happened, when there's been an examination of the internal housekeeping of any particular situation, that is the first step towards making change, because it sort of removes the cloud.
Yeah.
That's so true. Well, I feel like I've been in this space forever. I was born in this space, okay? So 25 years ago was the release of Boys in the Hood. That was my first movie. Another USC alum, John Singleton. And the power of that film was such an aha moment for me to see how an authentic portrayal of a group was so real and so human that it transcended just the specificity of South Central. And it traveled the world, it made a lot of money, he was nominated. The power of that just really stuck with me. And of course, I'm Black and I'm a woman, so it was what I was interested in. And I was at the studio at Columbia Pictures at the time. It's so important who's at the table. Because everybody should have a diverse, in any business actually, but especially in a business that creates images that travel the world, to have a diverse group at the table. Because what's important to me may not be important to you, and what's important to you may not be important to you. But if we all can represent and have a voice in that, then as it turns out, it makes more money. As it turns out, it can change the world, right? So for me, this is the space that I've been living in, and having the numbers has actually empowered me as well, because when I took over the festival, it became really self-evident to me that the programmers had to be diverse in order to have a diverse program. And Film Independent is the parent org that produces the Spirit Awards, very, very diverse, the Los Angeles Film Festival, and a bunch of programs throughout the year. So our mission for 30 years has been to support a community of artists who are diverse, number one, who are innovative and have a unique point of view. So I just felt when I took over the festival, we had an obligation to embody our mission statement. And so then I think it has to start with the intention. You have to say you want it in order to figure out how to get it. And then once we said, this is who we are, this is what we have to represent, we were very just calculated in how to get there and how to take action steps. First, having a diverse team at play so that the movies could be diverse. And then really looking, because the one thing that drives me crazy is that diversity somehow has been commingled with not good enough. Right, so people say, I'm just looking for the best. I'm just looking for the best. I don't want to think about diversity. I don't want to think about that. I just want to go for the best. But the best is so subjective. And then you have to dig deeper for the best of underrepresented things, because they are out there. And I think the work that a lot of us are doing is showing that there is excellent work out there. So that's my little 2 cents.
We also know from some research that the best person for the job, that phrase, that thinking can actually trip implicit biases and lead to discriminatory actions. So we have a series of questions to ask each of you about these changes that you've implemented. And let's start with Pete, and then Kate, you can take the next question. But Pete, I'm curious, how did you navigate getting how to get away with murder? How did you get that greenlit? Because the main character, right, might be a risk-averse decision. Was Viola the picture in your head? Walter Lippmann talks about stereotypes being pictured. Was she who you went after? How did you discover her to fit this role? And then how did you sell that when we know that these companies are often very diverse to taking risk when it comes to underrepresented racial or ethnic groups?
I'll just talk specifically about the process of this pilot, because it doesn't represent all. But when I wrote the pilot, you pitch the pilot and you pitch characters and stuff, but I never pitched ethnicity or anything within my characters. I don't write with any descriptors like that. And so it's just in the casting process that you discover what your cast is going to represent. And I think what's great about our casting director, Linda Lowy, and it creates a ton more work for casting directors, and I sometimes wonder if this is why people do write ethnicity into scripts, is they have to see everyone for every role. And so when you're, so basically we, on the pilot, like, you know, I was seeing, there's a young student named Michaela Pratt. I was seeing all ethnicities for that role, and I picked the actor who was my favorite. Her name's Asia Naomi King, and she's great. So that was one of the first roles we cast, and we just kept going from there. And Annalise was one of the final roles. And obviously we wanted someone extremely talented and awesome and dynamic. I never dreamed Viola Davis because I didn't want to dream that big. It was just my first pilot. And you know, I would have been open to anyone. But like Viola Davis, you're like, well, she's not gonna do this. So it was, it just came to us because she read it and she liked it, and then she, now she's on the show, which is the best thing that's ever happened to me as a person. So I write from a place where, like, especially, I think movies are different than TV because, like, you can discover so much about the character with the actor you've cast. I'm extremely collaborative. I love talking to the actors. They're actually a real checks and balances for me about certain things we write, like if they believe it for their character or not. Like, you know, I'm not a straight Republican, so Matt McGorry, I'll be like, do you believe this for your character? He's not either, but he's like inside his character. So we talk about things like that. In order, and especially with Viola, like casting her changed the direction of the character, and now we, things I never even imagined we're writing about in a way that like I'm learning, and it's exciting and fun, and we're putting new things into the world because of that collaboration. So for me in TV, like I would encourage everyone to just like not picture anyone specifically, but then to see who you get and who you can work with and get excited with. Movies, I think it's maybe different because you know that you're only going to have that story to tell. Like a pilot's just like a, just the first step in this character. A movie, like you might, I don't know. I've just been reading things recently about what the actor in Star Wars said. You know, like we should be writing ethnicity specifically into movie scripts. So I would be open to that in movies. I think it's different in TV because it's such a collaborative and long-term process.
Stephanie, I want to revisit what you were talking about with the LA Film Festival, because we know, Stacy's run the numbers, that it is one of the most inclusive film festivals in the country, maybe even the world. We'll just take a guess. Yeah, we've done those studies. There's not a lot of women directing short films out in the world. But so tell us about why you actually accepted the role of director and what you were hoping to make happen when you got there. You talked a little bit about that. And then what specific steps did you actually have to take? Because one of the things we try to do in the report is offer really concrete solutions. So what did you kind of set in motion for people to actually create an inclusive festival?
Sure. So I took the job because I'd spent a lot of my career launching first-time filmmakers, first-time writer-directors. And in order to do that, it takes a minute. So I would work and then drop a new film, and that writer-director would then go on to do other things, and then I'd work on somebody else. This way, I had an opportunity to really shine a spotlight on 20 to 50 new filmmakers, and that was really, really exciting to me. So it's just like mogulizing, you know, just more volume. And then when I got there, and I realized that it was a very homogenous group, and when I started to insert my ideas, I felt the resistance, and I feel this a lot. There's a natural pushback when you're a liberal, open, Los Angeles, Hollywood person, where you're not aware of some of the biases that are inherent. You're just not. You've never had to face them. You've never had to really explore them. So more difficult to explain to somebody who is a very open person, maybe you're not open enough. And it becomes it's a little threatening, frankly. I think it's a little threatening. So I just sort of gently, this took years, basically. This is my fifth year. It took years to sort of push and test the waters and put films in the festival that were, nobody would come, but then everybody would come, and just sort of gain confidence in the fact that we're in LA, one of the most diverse cities in the world. And I wanted to really make the festival reflect that diversity and also our mission statement. So that was the first thing. I just had to test it. Empirical evidence that it was working. That was my sort of toe in. Then when I realized that the resistance was not really going to go away, I created a sidebar that I was able to just populate with things that I felt needed to be out there. Well, that worked. And then a lot of those films sold. So eventually I gained the confidence to basically say, I need to have a programming staff that wants diversity. It's not just likes it or thinks it's cool or looking for the best, but a proactive team that actually had the intention to do that. That was really the biggest step. And then that team had to be diverse in and of itself. It could not just be a homogenous group who wanted diversity. It had to be a group that was diverse who wanted diversity. And then once I got that in place, then the mechanism was like, oh, shite, now we're in it. Like, now we have to deliver. Now we have to find all these movies, right? So what do you do? Well, they did it all. They called schools. They called, you know, HBCUs. They asked. They looked on Facebook. They trolled, like, who knows who's making films? The fact is, so many people, so many women are making films out there. And you can imagine that there's varying degrees of excellence in them. So you just have to keep looking, keep watching. Oh my God, the last week we found incredible films that were directed by women that we put in the festival that ended up selling. It was just because we wouldn't stop. We said we're going to find the best films out there. We set a goal. Our goal was, you know, at least 30%, like, the, you know, the numbers are appalling. We ended up with 40% of the films were directed by women and over 35 were directed by people of color. And this year I said I want 50. And I hope I'm gonna get it.
That's amazing. That's amazing, and that's why I asked you here, to tell that story. Because it is amazing, because you've only been there 5 years. You have target goals, a strategy, and you're meeting those goals, right? Cathy, we've worked together for over 3 years with data. Much of this approach that all of the panelists are mentioning, that the numbers are so important. Can you walk us through what Women in Film, the Sundance Institute, is up to? Now that you've amassed all this data, you're trying to set something in motion that has never been done before, that Steph and I actually participated in. Walk us through what the next steps are and why this is so important, because it references what we just heard.
Okay, I think I have to go a little bit backwards to go forwards in that question, and first examine why we did what we did, and then get to where we're headed with it. So the biggest reason that we started all of this was that the statistics that were existing already were unchanging, frustrating, and unexplained. And I certainly felt that running an organization as influential as Women in Film, that the notion that I was going to stand in front of people every year and talk about flatline statistics was not only terribly embarrassing, but also boring. And so it was time to make a change. And what we endeavored to do, and we partnered with the Sundance Institute to do it, was to find somebody who could help us do a different kind of data collecting. And that person turned out to be Stacy and then her team, as we've all been working so closely over the last few years. And the big difference of what we did and what had existed before that is that we were interested in understanding the entire cycle of what happens to women from the time that they enter the system, which can happen and be looked at in two different ways, you know, or measured, and there are many ways that it probably happens, but there's only certain things we can actually measure, and that's when do we get into schools that specialize in this area, and even more specifically, we could look at women as they enter the festival circuits, which is usually where the first films start to be seen. And the reason why I reached out to Sundance at the time to do this was we had been trying to figure out a way to create a control group. How could we analyze women who actually also had potential? Because if you tried to measure all of the women out there who might want to make a film, it could get kind of out of control. And at least starting at the festival was there's been some curatorial approach and we can count people and somebody has said there's something here to watch. So that's how we came together and what we started with Stacy. But what we wanted to do was to look at the cycle from there all the way through their third film. And this was a feature examination with some touches into television here and there, but primarily feature. And so the idea was, what are not just what are the numbers as we go, but what are the numbers in service of what are the fallout points? When are we losing women, and then why? Qualitative, quantitative, paired together, specialty of this team. And so we, now, by the way, when you say that, like all the way up to your third film, that's kind of a weird thing to say because frankly, 50% of women fall out before they get to their second film. So what kind of third film are we even talking about? And the numbers are so small, we start to be counting, you know, carrots in a bag kind of thing. But that was the notion of this research. But the key thing was where are the fallout points so that we can try to figure out why. And so we went through all of that. It was three phases of research and finally got to a point that we felt we had a pretty clear understanding of the problems within that trajectory cycle. And a number, and it wasn't so clean that it's all linear. There were a number of intersecting issues that we had to examine as well. So what we recently, and of course, okay, so what? Unless we do something about it. And one of the trickiest things about doing something about it is how are we going to get inside the halls of power where the decision making happens? How are we going to be inside the studios, inside the networks, inside the agencies? And we did discover that the problems were existing everywhere. And in a bit of a cat case chasing its tail kind of a way, the agencies saying, well, why would we sign women when we can't sell them to studios? And studios saying there's no women on the list that the agencies have. And agencies saying, well, we can't sign women because they have a short half-life. And who wants them when they're old, in front or behind the camera, and then the studio's saying, well, we really need young women, you know, all the different things, like circles upon circles. So how are we going to get inside of all of that? And thus began the quest for what next. And I guess I have to say one other thing. This is a big answer because it's an enormous question, so forgive me, but I'll try to get to the end soon. I thought for the longest time as we were going through this process that what we were going to discover, and we did, was that the main problem was one of metrics, that we were going to discover that the more amount of money involved, the more risk-taking involved financially on any particular piece of media would ultimately decrease the amount of women involved. And that's true. And a huge point, and it goes to what you were saying about what should we do in film versus what we do in television. You know, by nature, films cost more than television shows do. And anytime you're dealing with increased fees, a number of different things in the report suggested why, but also concluded very, very, very firmly that there is a decrescendo of opportunity when there's a crescendo of financial risk. Okay, so that was the main finding. But the key finding was odd because that is a key finding. But the main finding, as far as I'm concerned, was the very same thing we thought from the beginning to the end, unconscious bias. Isn't that a bummer? You might have thought that after 3 years of research and looking at every single fact and figure and point and, 30,000 data points here and there, more at times, that you might come up with, oh my God, the missing ingredient was ketchup. And it was just not that. It was unconscious bias again. So what it really means is, why are we doing what we're doing, and why do we keep repeating old problems over and over again to create statistics like the ones that you saw tonight? So what are we doing about it? So based on this notion and our understanding of it, our feeling was we're going to have to bring together people who we feel are important decision makers in Hollywood coming from those exact same places, the buyers, the people in the studios and the networks and the agencies, et cetera. There's more distributors, international salespeople, et cetera, but in general, bring these decision makers together. And we put together recently a summit where we had about 50 very influential, you had to be a president or above, people come from various aspects of the industry, and we split it, men and women. That was a key thing. We're in the friending men stage for all you men out there. All about friending men. Because we need you to help us here. And plus, we don't want to keep talking to ourselves. It's boring. So we put all these people together, and we started to think, what do we need to do, and how are we going to get in? And here's where we are today. So we have spent the last 6-8 months working with all sorts of specialists, mostly in the systemic research fields. Some of you have probably heard of systems mapping and things like this by now. And this is when you try to look at a whole microcosm involved in a particular industry where people are going to have different needs and different desires and different economics. And I don't know, take fish, you know, somebody needs to fish, take a, you know, needs to take a, they did a big, big systemics mapping program in fish. And I bring it up only because it's easy to understand, you know, like somebody wants to fish a fish to eat it. Another person needs to throw garbage in the ocean to test for cancer drugs. Or the person, you know, whatever it is, there's going to be people in any one of these sort of cosmic circles that are going to have different agendas. But we have to get into that space where we can all agree. And here's what we tried to do. We're trying to say that there should be one thing that's easy to agree on. And that thing is that if the media that we create and export does not involve women and girls and their stories, then what the heck are we saying about the place, like you said, the dean said very, very, I thought importantly in the first words out of his mouth and the most important words probably of the night, is that this really does matter because it's about what happens in the world, right? What are we saying about, like, if we keep saying that we don't hear from, like you said, half of the decision-making table and half of the people at the table, then which, you know, people are we going to elect? Which wars are we going to wage? How are we going to run our schools? Everything is affected. So it becomes a crucial issue. So how are we going to make this change? So what we decided to do is to create essentially ambassador groups. And they are groups of peers that will go inside each of these halls of power. And when I say peers, here are the things that haven't worked. Specialists, educators, researchers, philanthropists, academics, diversity groups. Because something happens that they're too separate. The industry is so weird and clicky that, right, that they just go, oh, you're supposed to talk to human resources over there where they care about diversity. And we don't really know what building they're in, but once in a while we get a report for them. But could you, like, give it to me on a day I'm not so busy, you know? And so that wasn't really working. So we thought, well, what if the very same people that you deal with every day, the same agents, the same producers, the same actors, the same directors, the same writers, the same financiers, whatever it is, came in groups and spoke to you about what was happening inside of your walls. And we're putting together a program where this ambassador group, which is being trained now, heavy, heavy training for many, many months, so that they're actually educated enough to speak about this, not to teach themselves, but to bring in experts and teachers into these organizations. But what you need to know to even do that and to make it unified is a big deal. So they'll be doing that, and when we go in, we're going to focus on three things. We're going to focus on unconscious bias training, which is key to everything, which is, do you know what you're saying? Do you know what you're doing? Do you understand how you're thinking? And gracefully, and hopefully not too painfully, and without insult and blame, let's look at that. That's number one. Number two, we are looking to institute a certification or marking program, in which, is that the right thing to call it at this point? Stephanie's very involved in this part. You know, where we are going to be rating, both from the inside and the outside, the performance that companies in power have in terms of their hiring practices and the product that they create.
Oh, sorry, but not in a punitive way, but inspirational way. So, you know, the
you're
ones who
for
are
high
doing
marks.
Well, you get the good marks.
That's right. And we're not saying you go do this yourself. We're saying that we're in here with you, with the educator. We're raising so much money and need more for all the rich people in the room. Did you say there are a few trustees in the room? Anyway, we are raising money right now because the process of doing this is going to require that we stay in there as friends, as colleagues, as peers, like I was just talking about, right? We have to be inside there and we can't leave our own companies. I'm the president of a studio right myself right now. You know, I know full well how hard this is going to be. And even with me, who knows a lot about it in there, I can't make the change. It's going to take a lot of lean-in from a lot of people for a while. And so when we talk about the certification process, it should be your own. Like, you're looking to increase your possibility. What we need to do that is to prove why that's economically beneficial, which is the key to everything. The next study that we haven't announced yet, that's probably now announced, as I'm about to do it, but that we'll be working on with Stacy and the group, will be a very, very intensive economic analysis of what's really happening in the marketplace. How are movies by, about, for women and girls, actually, not just movies, we'll probably be doing all of media, how are they performing? Very hard thing. You know, a couple studies have come out already where people have tried to tell you that. Don't believe any of them. They're crappy. Because they aren't taking into account all of the variations. You can't compare an apple to an orange. You can't compare a movie that was made for $7 million with $2 million of marketing to another movie that was made for $10 million with $20 million of marketing. You can't compare a movie that came out on 4th of July to one that came out in the Super Bowl. You can't, you know, so there's a million factors. And what this essentially is a combination of the social science kind of work that's done here with mathematics and other kinds of things. So, okay, second thing was the certification program. And then thirdly and lastly, and these are only the beginning things. So the unconscious bias training, ability to analyze what's happening in terms of your own internal housekeeping. Two, this self-certification and external certification process. And three, putting together a cross-industry sponsorship program. You know, there's a lot of focus in Hollywood on mentoring. Mentoring is a really important thing, but it tends to have a truncated feel to it. It's I'm with you for a year and then I'm gone and then you go off and good luck. What we're trying to do is create an ongoing network that takes people beyond entry level into intermediate and senior careers that stays with women particularly as they go, but also doesn't only create one mentor in one place. It's a network. So you may have somebody who sponsors you at STX, another person at Warner Brothers, another person, you know, at ABC, another person at NBC, you know what I mean? And you might find this, and that these people will be working to match people up so you can actually speak for people economically too. You're kind of putting yourself on the line. I sponsored this person and I vouch for the fact that they will not lose your money. And then what do you do if they do? That's where it gets a little more complicated, but we're working on all those things too. So anyway, that was a very long answer from start to finish, but basically we are calling this project Conversion. We are moving the conversation away from awareness, which is what we were doing for the last 3 years with the press campaign and the research, into the conversion process and trying to see if we can make lasting change.
I didn't cut you off on purpose because I wanted all the folks in here to actually bear witness, because these are three levers. If you do not push these three levers simultaneously, you will not create change. So what you just heard was a theory for change to roll out. Stephanie's been doing this already with the festival. Pete's already been doing this with How to Get Away with Murder. But the Systemic Change Group is really working across leaders to push those levers to create change. So if this works, we should see change as quickly as the LA Film Festival does, if you really think about the practical implications of setting this into motion. I don't know where we're at on time, Kate.
I think it's time to open up to the audience.
Okay.
So that was perfect. Well timed. Are there questions?
For our panel.
We have a question upstairs, actually, and we were instructed to look to the second floor, so we're doing that.
Hi, my name is Jay. I'm the president and founder of the USC Black Actors Union. Can you guys talk about accurate depictions of people of color in media? I feel like there's a lot of versions of stereotypes, especially for African Americans, where it comes to violence and gangs. And even with the LGBT community, there's a lot of stereotypes. Can you talk about what happens in the writer's room? Are you guys really focused on accurate reflections or really just stereotypes that are reflecting people in negative light?
Well, I think our goal is to not write the stereotypes, but I'm sure sometimes we accidentally do that. But for me, the writer's room and the people I've hired in the writer's room are there to kind of check me as the head writer, and that we're all checking each other. So it's a very inclusive group, and it's very representative of the people on our show. I think one of the things that I found very liberating about my show is that they're bad people. And they don't have to be perfect, or we don't have to write towards any stereotype, and that's felt transgressive to me. And exciting, because I think, you know, the minute you start writing people as perfect, and they're boring, you know, and who wants to watch that? And so somehow, I don't know how that happened on our show, but I think one of the most liberating things is that we get to write people who are really flawed and specific and don't have to represent anyone but the character. Like, I get very defensive when people are like, oh, don't you feel like Connor, the gay character, is a white man, and so am I. Don't you feel bad when he's like so oversexed, and isn't that stereotypical and cliche? I'm like, you know what, that's who he is. And one way that I check that stereotype is that we have another gay character on the show who isn't that. So it's kind of about balance. Like, for me, it's like, can we, if we're gonna do something that feels kind of cliche, and of course it's like the goal to subvert it, But is there anything else on the show that challenges that and counterbalances it? And I think that's what's great about TV is that you can write a lot of different characters in one episode so you get that balance.
I think one of the reasons why I do what I do is to create more depictions that can really finally squash a lot of the stereotypes that, you know, were basically established in 1915 in Birth of a Nation. And so that's what's really exciting, to really show us as we are in so many different ways. And I think that's just an individual, you know, that's my mission. And I'm sure there's a lot of other people out there that have that mission, but you as an actor, you know, it's about the roles that you choose to play. You know, I want to play Hollywood Shuffle at the festival. It's going to be 40 years, which is kind of crazy, but because those ideas of, you know, you go to auditions and they want you to play, and there was this other interesting, article in the New York Times evaluating all of the roles that won Oscars. I don't know if anybody read that, but it was frightening that for a lot of, especially black women, homeless, you know, just the worst, right? And so, how do you counter that? Because these images travel the world. And I have two black sons. When they're out on the street, they are looked at based on these images. They are treated a certain way based on these images. And that's my goal, is to really create enough content that really dispels those stereotypes.
Joy? I think we'll ask Joy down here.
Hi, thank you.
Should I stand? Pretty close. Okay. Hi, thanks for being here. My name is Joy. I was a reporter, coder on CARD, and I'm also with African American Cinema Society. My question is for you, Stephanie. Gina visited the school earlier and talked about her experience with Beyond the Lights and how she really wanted to get across to this world this beautiful black love story between Gugu and Nate, but she struggled with each studio going to it, and they said, can you cast Channing Tatum, or can you cast this white actor? I wanted to know if, when you're producing films and you're going around, is that something that's common? Is that a trend that you're really trying to get across this great story, but a studio won't say yes unless the lead is a white male?
Look, they know when they see me coming what they're gonna get. So I don't really have that problem anymore, but I obviously produced that movie with Gina. You know, black love is very important to her, is very important to me. We did not have any conversations about casting a white guy in the role of Nate, in the Nate Parker role. So I think, you know, it's about marketing. It's about having a name that somebody knows, right? So you can sell, which is what they say. Here's a big thing. How come the press hasn't reported that Straight Outta Compton has made like $60 million overseas,
right?
Absolutely. Or Creed has made $50 million overseas. You do not see those articles. And so the industry sort of operates on these truisms that aren't really even true anymore, you know? And so the more info, like you guys are doing, the more info we have, that you can put that in front of people, because it is about the numbers and they do want to cast somebody. But our job is to really push hard, because we need more stars, you know? We need more actors that they can say, I want to bet on this person, or I want to bet on that movie. And if they don't have these roles growing up, then how do you become a star, you know?
Yeah, so I think, yeah, you have to look at the whole system of building, you know, careers, because, you know, making green lighting decisions myself, I mean, we have had three movies fall apart this year that we tried to build with African American leads, and it was because we could not get the economics right. And there's ultimately going to be, there will always be a reckoning moment with the financier who has to meet a bottom line as to, there must be a model on a movie for anyone to greenlight it that makes people believe that the downside risk is not worse than equal, you know, worse than you got out alive. And so the problem is everything's outdated. The numbering systems are outdated. The data collection is outdated. What's happening in the, and a lot of it has to do with what's happening in the foreign territories. It's all changing. We got to catch up with it fast. I had the same experience on International with Crash, which was a movie, by the way, answering your question, that specifically was about the stereotyping, to show that the stereotyping is wrong. It changes all the time. But there's so many issues that have to do with, you know, how many parts has this person played? What's been the proliferation of this character? Is the character against type? All the different things. Go ahead.
Yeah, how many Twitters do they have? All that stuff. But the one thing I will say is that what I'm hearing a lot more in the halls are, we can't have the all-white poster anymore.
That's absolutely true.
We cannot have it. Like that's like the first sign that you can see that people are thinking without one of us being in the room.
Yeah, so my company is 100% committed to that. There's no question. We don't want to lose money by putting out an all-white poster, let alone, you know, be unrepresentative of the truth.
And it's true that if you see an all-white poster and you're driving by, you it feels
like
archaic.
Who's this for?
Like, it just doesn't feel real. It doesn't feel, you know, is that a period piece? Or what's happening? I don't know.
But this issue of getting diverse people in the lead roles is the hardest part. The biggest thing we're all overcoming is, how is that lead person going to be diverse? And that's where we need to head. And it's going to take all of this work, you know, to move it. But we have to do it fast.
I think it's interesting, if you ever are curious about how this works, go to IMDb Pro and look at the companies that are releasing these films. Because if you look at over 100 films, you'll notice a pattern very quickly. It doesn't matter the year. Distribution density, where these films are going internationally, if there's a white lead, male or female, they're going all over the world, particularly with a white male lead. If it's a female lead, there'll be less. If it's a person of color in the lead role, the distribution internationally is a fraction of what they put behind a film with a white male lead. So it's a real problem, because we ran the numbers a few years ago and we could not believe the number of films that made over 500 million, I believe was the price point, doing really well internationally. And so without that economic data, you have nothing to counter argue. But if you look at the patterns, they're being stopped from putting the marketing behind those films, because Beyond the Lights and Belle failed because of marketing. Phenomenal stories. They should have been in the top 100, but because they didn't have the P&A, they didn't soar over the mark.
And sometimes they don't have the P&A because you can't get the modeling right to spend the right P&A. And yeah, this is where the whole thing is. You have to always remember, when we're, for all of us, you know, when we're dealing with all of this, I like to say this, and some of you have probably heard it before, but there's a reason it's called show business. It really is not show. And the fact is that one doesn't work without the other in this particular art form. You know, it's different if you're making a sculpture or this or that, a poem. But like when you are completely judged by how many ticket sales, how many butts in the seat, how many tickets you can sell, it's about how much marketing can you spend, how many people can you attract, and what can you deliver. All of that has to be analyzed in order to spend the money. And the bites are huge. I mean, when you're talking about institutional financiers, non-independent, you know, movies are costing, as you know, $10 to $200 million. And so a lot of capital is moving. And it's a tricky thing. That's why we have to fix all these problems, so that the capital can be properly deployed. But until the decision, and it goes back to what Stephanie said, until the decision-making tables are more representative, it's not going to happen. We're going to keep getting this skew. We're going to keep skewing. And then the economics will keep being bad.
I think we have a question down in front.
Putting on my teacher hat, one of the things that you described is really fascinating is this mapping system you're going to do. And so I assume that's going to be from beginning to end, and then what are the pressure points along the way. So what I would like to ask the panelists to consider is, how would that be as a teaching tool? Yeah. What could our students who are in the room today learn from seeing the way this thing is put together, especially since 10 years ago, it's all upside down and inside out. and a lot of our students aren't as aware as you are of what's the beginning, what's the middle, how should they prepare for a career in that kind of market. So if you could maybe address what could our students learn from the kind of systems approach you're talking about, if, as I hope you will do, you'll release it to the public, that approach.
Well, I guess for me, you know, one point of view is I've always felt that there's two ways to look at, that they have to approach this issue from two different directions. One is, what are you doing with the decision makers and how are you changing the ways things are done? And the other is, how are we preparing ourselves to intersect with the system as is and the system that changes, and hopefully will change for the benefit. And I mean, frankly, like what Women in Film has been trying to do 365 days a year for you, you know, is exactly that, is to better prepare, you know, women in that particular case, you know, to intersect with the process. But you do run into a lot of problems that you actually mentioned in your opening remarks too, which is the issue of assimilation versus self-distinguishing, which is you don't want to just get in to get in so that you can do what they do already. You want to get in so you can have a voice and make change. So, I guess the question, the question of, you know, what I hope that the work and the data, there's two different things going on. There's the systemic research project. The systemic project is going into these studios with these ambassador groups. The research that's going to go alongside, which is I think what you're focusing on, we will. I think the answer is we need to do it in a way that it comes to conclusion, that the conclusions are instructive. Yet, I don't know the answers yet. Do you know the answers to this question as an academic?
Well, we've done some of the economic work before, but what I'd like to do and what I'm imagining doing is creating a whole series of scenarios. So let's take Beyond the Lights, for example. What would have happened to Beyond the Lights if you would have price point marketing, print and advertising cost at different levels? How would that affected your bottom line? So that we can create simulations of risk profiles in terms of the money put behind films of the type of ROI that you can receive domestically and internationally. So I have some hunches about what might occur, but I think what's most important is providing the industry with what would have happened if you increased these costs and distributed the film similar to how you would distribute a film featuring a white male.
Yeah, and you probably have to look at the other side. That's a good idea. And I think what you have to do is you have to look at the other side too, which is what made up the negative costs. The way that movies, the economics of films, the simplest way to look at it, and most of you, I'm sure, know this by now, is that you've got the negative cost is what's put into the budget, right? What does it cost to make it? And then the financing is, you know, how do you finance that amount that makes up that budget with the least risk? And so that when you get to the marketing, you're not upside down just from the process of financing the negative. And so you have to look at both, how are you financing the movie and what does it cost? And then on the other side, what are you spending to actually market it? And this gets really complicated too because of pricing issues. Like, take agencies. And throw them all in the ocean. No. We did it. Solved. But this is a whole thing, too. What we're out of control in terms of pricing, in terms of talent and things. So this is we're still coming off of the 90s, where one particular agency, CAA, you know, came up with the star system, which made someone believe in the very first of these deals that Sylvester Stallone should be paid $20 million to make a movie when no one had ever been paid more than $2.5 million. And so we're so out of skew in terms of what is the talent costing and what are the directors, what is everything costing, you know. Then we've also got this kind of gross dependency on special effects that gets worse and worse the more we enter into the digital era, believe it or not, because it becomes more and more tech savvy. So now we've got we're trying to wow each other with technological things while we're also overpricing the talent. So we have to look at all of that, and why is that making the movie cost $40 million instead of $20 million? And that we're not too upside down. And then we have to figure out, well, now that we've made a movie that's put us $20 million under, how much are we actually going to believe in the future and market it at the same level as the movie that didn't put you under that? Which is why this is so complicated, if you're following that. So what we need to do is figure out those metrics and then put out that work and teach it in the schools so that we're preparing people to pick the right kinds of projects for the economics that exist. And that's the biggest problem with schools and intersection with the industry anyway. I just say it from working at all the different schools over the years, you know, trying to get into a realistic profiling of what it is that you're passionate about and what your art wants to be, which is why you're learning. We want you to do your great, wonderful, passionate stories. But then how to take that, measure it properly against possibility of economics and come up with something that can propel your career. It's a very, very difficult equation, but something we have to get into much more deeply and really, really problematic still in all of the schools.
Which is why it's so important, the independent space is so important to train yourselves, to learn how to make a movie, to pick up a, you can make a movie with an iPhone, you guys, you know, pick up something and train yourself so that when you get to the point where you're in front of somebody like Cathy, you already have three movies under your belt. You're already able to express yourself visually and understand the making of the film. And also with all these new platforms, with Hulu, with Amazon, with Netflix, you can go out and make a movie, which my sons did, and then license it to Netflix. It's playing on Netflix, French Dirty, check it out. It's pretty amazing, you know? And this is an economic model that works for the filmmaker, and it's really incumbent upon, I think, the students to really do the work now before you get to that level.
I think we might have time for one more, Kate, is that?
I think so, and I'm gonna send it to Jess because we like Jess a lot. So I'm playing favorites.
Thanks, I love you guys too. So my name is Jess Wiener. I'm an agent for social change in the media space as well, an ally of this conversation and an adjunct professor here in personal branding and entrepreneurship. So I kind of wanted to build off of what you were talking about with systemic change. What on a practical level as consumers do? We take this information, we integrate it. There's been amazing, the ecosystem has been amazingly explained to a degree tonight. But when we leave and we have a choice to go spend $15 this weekend, you know, or refer a friend to something on our social platforms or whatnot, can we get into the tactical of like, what do we do as content lovers and change makers as well so that we can help you spread this conversation systemically in our worlds?
This is so important. Thank you for that question, because when we talk about wanting diverse voices out there and wanting to see movies that are directed by women or people of color, and then we do not spend the money, the $15 at the movie theater, you're not going to get there that way. So it is really incumbent upon us to really be heard with our dollars and to spend that money and to support movies. I don't want to beat a dead horse, but Beyond the Lights was on a top 10 list at the New York Times, all over the place. Where were my girls? You know what I mean? They weren't there. And so you can't ask for that and then not support it when it's in front of you. So I appreciate that.
I wanted to just point you to one little thing going on, but that I think is starting to have a kind of crazy impact because it's gotten into the many thousands now in terms of members. But Women in Film has a program going on right now called 52 Films by Women. I see some of you nodding already, and you just go onto the website and you log in to basically say that you will commit to watch one film by a woman once a week, every week of the year. And it's also growing into a social campaign so that this will create a list of those filmmakers, and it will create commentary on those filmmakers, and it will create a hiring list. And that's all being built out, so that's one thing you can do. And I was also just going to say, just on a more general sense, that, and we're working on a PSA campaign right now, which will be called something along the lines of Demand Your Media. Every one of the exhibitors and distributors that exists has sites. And I don't know how oftentimes you go to the actual company sites. Not a lot of people don't know which company made what movie, but if you take the time to figure out, you can go through the movie or go through the company. There are all sorts of places all over these studio and film websites asking you what you thought of films and things like that. But there's general areas where they're saying, what do you want this studio to do for you? It's really important to like write in, make more movies like that, make movies that have this. Why doesn't anybody believe that so-and-so's a star? We all do. My 15 friends and I did this. You'd be surprised how collective voice can make a change if you just speak up and ask for your own media and don't just sit there hoping somebody figures you out.
Pete, how about you?
Just along those lines, I mean, I've obviously in Shondaland and our show and Scandal, Twitter has been extremely powerful, and Black Twitter specifically has changed and gotten to the heads of all the studios. Like, if, you know, that's just a very simple way.
Excellent. Well, I want to thank all of our panelists, and I hope you'll join me in thanking all our panelists. And before you take off, Dean Wilson will close the event with a special nod that he'd like to give. So come on up, Ernie, and thank you again for coming tonight.
First of all, anybody, any students who came tonight gets extra credit. So let's give a big shout out of thanks to our three professors who have showed up tonight. And I just want to close very, very briefly by saying, as part of the ongoing work of the Annenberg School for Communication and Journalism, we are proud to announce tonight that we will be handing out an award to the individual in the entertainment industry who has done the most to promote diversity and inclusion and empowerment. And so we'll be doing that in the month of March. We have selected a group that will be identifying potential sources or potential folks to win that award. So if you have any suggestions, please send them to Stacy Smith. Not to me, to Stacy. Especially our panelists, if you would like to recommend yourselves or others, please do that. But what we really do believe is that the Annenberg School, especially through the work of Stacy and others who are committed to this, we've got to be smart about it. Analytics counts. Learn the math. Learn the analytic approaches. But also remain engaged with the profession. It's not enough to sit here in this wonderful building. We've got to engage with our colleagues who are on the other side of the building. And I know we're going to be committed to doing that in the future. And so I think we've got probably a couple hundred brilliant young people, millennials in this room, who have been inspired by what we've seen tonight, and I know will want to work alongside of all of you on the stage. But let me again turn it back to Stacy and say thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you. Enjoy the evening, and there's a reception afterwards, so partake.